must have had certain expectations or thoughts about what it would be like to be a police officer in Weston. Were those expectations met, or what did you learn in the first weeks and months of your job that may have run counter to your expectations?
Well, I think most of us know about police work maybe from TV shows when we're growing up. And one of my favorite TV shows when I was growing up was Adam 12. So when you see a show like that where there's something exciting going on every time that first half hour, when that half hour TV show happens, you kind of get the impression that all police work is like that. So one of the things you learn pretty quickly when you get into actually doing police work is there's a lot of hurry up and wait going on. And you can approach it in a couple different ways. You can have the most boring career as a police officer if you're just sitting around waiting for things to happen to respond to. Or if you go out there and actually interact with the public, and which could be in many forms, going to the town center and getting out and talking to people, or going up to the schools and talking to the kids, or getting to know the teaching staff, or you know, just getting to know people in town and being out there, versus just sitting around and waiting for things to happen. You think you have a much more fulfilling career as a police officer, especially in a small town, by getting to know the people in town. And that's what I tried to do. Most people already knew me already because my parents were well established here. But for me to get out there and get to know people was one of the biggest, I think, the steps forward in a career in a small town that you take as a police officer. So what I'm trying to say is there's a lot of quiet and idle time in between excitement and, you know, running after the bad guys. It's you never can tell what's going to happen from shift to shift. You can go weeks without having any calls that you have to respond to when you're just, you know, doing routine patrol and radar and pulling cars over for speeding or other moving violations. And then there's other times when you're responding to real big emergencies, which could be anywhere from a fatal accident to a suicide call to domestic violence call to a child abuse call. And I think probably the misconception that people may have about Weston is that, oh yeah, it's a quiet town, so what do the police do here? And from my experience and seeing things from as a police officer, we call it looking through police color glasses. I can tell you from my experience, Weston isn't as quiet as people would think. But we, as police officers in Weston, have the luxury that we don't have the same volume of instances where we have emergencies that we respond to that some bigger cities do or bigger towns do. Weston is somewhat of almost an enigma when it comes to that, that it does have the appearance of being very quiet on the surface, but there's a thin veneer that the police work underneath where there's a lot happening. Just like in any big city, we have all the same kind of calls, just they're spread out over longer periods of time. And in the beginning, when I first started, I was never bored. I mean, I was always anxious to be out in the community and to learn from the people that I was working with, especially. And a lot of what you learn is from hearing stories about things that those officers have been through that I had no knowledge of growing up as a teenager.
So it sounds like you had never had any second thoughts about joining the police department.
No. I was there 36 years, and I got to say this about my career as a police officer in Weston. I've got to say that I owe Weston a huge debt of gratitude for giving me the opportunities that were given to me. I was 22, just 22, when I was hired as a part-time police officer in the fall of 1980. And I went through 60 hours of training in the classroom, one day on the range, a five-hour training session on the range with my sidearm. And as soon as I was done with that, Christmas Day, 1980, was my first work day. I worked with Bruce Turner and Gene Maloney, who eventually left. But after just simple 60 hours of training, and which is unheard of now. And then when I was hired full-time, it was when Gene Maloney decided to leave and go to the Westport Fire Department, and that was February of 1981. So literally, by the time I got hired full-time, I didn't go to the academy until May 18th of 1981. So from February 25th, 1981 to May 18th, 1981, I was out on the road, a full-time police officer with no real experience other than the 60 hours of, you know, classroom training and one day on the range that I had with my sidearm. And I was a full-fledged police officer responding to calls and handling calls in the town of Weston as a 22-year-old kid. Now, a lot has changed since then. The training requirements are a lot different. But it's something to think about, how things have kind of transcended into where we are now as police officers, the amount of training that's required and all of that. And we can get into that later, but it was something to think about. Even me thinking about it now, it almost gives me a chill that I had that much responsibility at age 22 with 60 hours of training.
Was there ever a time when you thought you might not want to do this job?
There was a time when I thought I wanted to do the job somewhere else. And that was between 1985 and 1987. And like I told you, one of my favorite TV shows growing up was Adam 12. So in that sense, I believe that, you know, everybody feels that they want to get into a situation where they've got more action. As a police officer, you find out later when you've been in the career for a while that quieter is better. But when you're young and you're in your 20s, you're looking to really get into some real police work, as it were. And I actually had some friends that moved out to California at that time from Weston. And I went out to visit them, and they were living out in Oxnard, California. So I went to visit the police station in Oxnard. And they were hiring, they were going through a hiring process. So I filled out an application without even really thinking about it. And about a month later, they contacted me and they wanted me to come back and take the physical agility. So I went back out there, took the physical agility. Didn't think anything about it, I passed it, of course. And then about a month later, they wanted me to come out and take the written test because I passed the physical agility. So I went out and took the written test, hung out with my friends for a few days. Passed the written test, and it turns out of 600 applicants, I came out number 23. So then they were like, okay, we want to do a background on you, we want to do an oral board on you, and this and that and the other thing. So I went out and did all those things. During that time, Chief McAleen, who was the chief of police at that time in Weston, wanted to know, what the hell's going on? You're taking all these trips out to California. So I told him what was happening. And he said, I'm not going to stand in your way, but you know, you have to decide what you want to do with your career. You have a career here, but I understand young guys, they're looking for action. They want to do something bigger. So I'm not going to stand in your way. So anything you need, if you need time off, whatever, I'll grant that to you, and you can go back and forth and test with the Oxnard Police Department. So I did, and I got to the point where they wanted me to come out and go to the Cadet Academy. And I was going to be going in a couple of months, so pretty much what I did was, before I made the final decision, I went back out there and I had made friends with a detective, I can't remember the detective's name out there in Oxnard PD, but I do remember there was a Sergeant Lewis that I made friends with. And I went out, I took some time, I sat and talked with him, just, you know, I was telling him I was trying to make this big decision as to stay in Weston or, you know, come out to Oxnard. And we compared notes on some things. And one of the detective that I was friends with, became friendly with, he had looked like a withered arm. And he said he was on light duty for like the last 8 years because he went to a domestic and somebody pulled a gun and shot him through the top of the hand and it came out his elbow. And he ended up having to shoot and kill the person who was shooting at him. But, you know, he was crippled because of it. And then Sergeant Lewis told me some different stories that he had about things that he was dealing with out there. And again, Oxnard seemed like a quiet place. It was a farming community for the most part, a lot of open space. But again, the thin veneer of what goes on up here that the public sees and what goes on beneath it, what the police see, two different things. Basically, Sergeant Lewis said, if I could, I would trade places with you. I would give you my sergeant stripes, and I would trade with you and go back to Weston and be a patrolman. So it was that that helped me make my decision to stay in the Weston Police Department. And then from that point on, I never looked back, and I always looked forward. And I never regretted staying in Weston on the police department.
You know, one of the people we interviewed was Bob Turner, who came here when he first entered politics, started to volunteer for town jobs. He said in those days it was like an old boys club, good old boys club. It strikes me from your stories whether to ask the question whether or not that was also the case with the police department. It almost sounded like more of a, quote, club of guys, you know, kind of running around than it did as a, sort of, quote, police force. Was it a lot less informal? Did you guys make, were you more social with the public? How did that work?
I think back in the early 80s and even into the 90s, the early part of the 90s, I think the police department was a different place to work. I think a lot of it had to do with the training requirements. As time went forward, there were a lot more training requirements as far as being on the range with your weapon, as far as requirements to even get hired as a police officer to have some kind of college under your belt, an associate's degree, or something around those lines. Where when I started out, I had college credits, but I did not have a degree. So I think too, the professionalism, I kind of think, comes along with the times. So when Chief McLean was the chief of police, he came from a time, he started in the 50s. I believe he started in 1956 in the Westport Police Department. Now, I was born in 1958. So he kind of grew up as a police officer in the 50s into the 60s and into the early 70s. When 1975, he was hired as the first police chief. Now, he's bringing his knowledge and experience from the 50s and 60s into the 70s and then into the 80s. But as time progresses, things change. There's more to the police job than there was in the 50s and the 60s. I think in the 50s and the 60s, and I'm not speaking from any real knowledge of it, but from what I gather, is that there was less requirement for education, there was less training involved on a regular basis, and those kind of things progress into the new different time periods. The equipment you carry becomes more, we carried revolvers in the beginning. I had a .357 revolver, Smith & Wesson. And we graduated then to the semi-automatic pistols, which was the Beretta 9mm in the early 90s. So the first 10 years or 12 years that I was on the police force, I carried a revolver, which has 6 bullets in it, and it was a certain way to train with those. But then we graduated into the semi-automatic pistols. It's a completely different animal. So we had to train with those, but there was more of a requirement at that time from the academy to be on the range a certain amount of hours per year. From that point on, we graduated up to the 40 caliber Glock semi-automatic pistols. And then we acquired rifles, the .223 rifles, that basically they're assault rifles to respond to that type of an attack. So there's a lot more that's happening in the world that the police departments have to graduate up and try to respond to with their training and their equipment. Where they didn't have school shootings back in the 60s and the 70s that I ever heard about, that tends to be a trend now, which happened most recently, actually, of course, in Sandy Hook back in 2012. So all of these things you're trying to, I used to tell people, as chief of police, what's your basic function? And I said, well, basically you think nationally but act locally. Excuse me, let me just have a drink of water quick.
I think it's inherent to the job of being a policeman and is sort of a good boys club, because you work so many shifts. You don't have a lot of extra friends. You know,
right.
Your friends are your police officers who understand that you can't,
right.
You know, you're working midnight, so you can't come to this party or you can't go to dinner or something. So
right.
I think it tends to be.
I'm kind of getting back to that in kind of a long way, but it's kind of to understand where police are, like you said. Mm-hmm. And you would know more than most people because you're married to one. So But in any case, so what I tell people as a police chief, but as a police officer, nowadays people think nationally, officers think nationally and act locally. To how do we respond to something that, like a Sandy Hook incident in town? Are we prepared to respond to something like that? And I think the burden of a police officer, and I was finding this out early on, is you respond to these tragedies and you see things, you see real tragedy in real time, and you're supposed to just be kind of the rock that shows up at that situation. But then you're a human being too, so how do you deal with that? And the only people you can really talk to, you can't talk to your mom and dad about going to a suicide scene. You can't talk to your mom and dad about a fatal car accident with the horrendous blood and gore that's involved with some of that. So what do? You talk to your friends who tend to be the guys you work with. And those are the guys that have seen it before if they weren't at that scene, or they were at the scene with you. And then the only way you can really get through it is to really talk about it. So sometimes you talk about it, but if the general public were listening to you, they would think that's disrespectful the way they're talking about it, because actually you're making jokes about it. But you have to deal with this tragedy somehow. You can't internalize it. You can't take it personally. You can't get attached to it. So you have to somehow joke about it or do something that helps you at least like vent it. And then if you can't totally vent it, you have to be able to compartmentalize that situation and put it away on a shelf somewhere. So that's where you start understanding how police officers tend to group together, because they share maybe not the same experience, but they share an experience of dealing with these tragic situations more on a regular basis than in any other group of people. And that includes firemen and EMTs, I would say. You know, you see it before all the other people come to show up to help. So I think, yeah, that it's as far as a good old boys or a boys club, I think to a certain extent that is true, but I think that the reasoning behind it is because of the shared experience, and then nobody else would understand why you're talking about this suicide or this fatality, like kind of with a tongue-in-cheek kind of a response, where most people would think, that's terrible, that's horrible, you're a horrible person for making a joke about that. But you have to be able to vent it, and you have to be able to compartmentalize it and put it away, because you're going to have something else to deal with. Otherwise, you're in the wrong business if you can't do that.
You didn't actually become sergeant and then chief. You just went from patrolman to chief, correct?
No, actually, I was patrolman for 25 years. And I had taken at least 4 promotional exams in that time period. I think it was 4. It was 3. And then the 4th one I took in 2005 was when Terry Mooney was sergeant and he left, so his position was open. And I said to myself and I said to my family, I'm going to take this test one more time, and if it doesn't work out, I'm just going to be a patrolman the rest of my career, which I enjoyed. So I took the sergeant's exam and I came out number 1 after everything was said and done. And I interviewed with the police commission and they gave me the position. They appointed me as the sergeant. I pretty much hit the ground running with the responsibility, but the prerequisite to that was I was the PBA president for 8 years. I was currently the union president, and I was able to convey to the police commission that, you know, if you give me the sergeant's position, it's going to be the same person you're sitting across from negotiating a police contract. It's going to be the same person that you knew as the PBA president that was just out doing public relations things in the community. It's not going to change me. You're still going to be able to talk to that same person, even though I have sergeant stripes on. And I'm willing to take on the added responsibility as a sergeant, being a supervisor of the guys that used to be on my same level. But now I'm supposed to be a step above them, and now they have to start working for me, and I'm going to be telling them how to do their job or what to do. So they gave me the position, and I hit the ground running with it. And I was the sergeant for about 18 months. At that time, it was just me and Sergeant Daubert, who were in-house. Sergeant Ferullo was on active duty. He's in the Coast Guard. So he was taken away on active duty during that time. And at that same time, Chief Land ended up leaving for whatever reasons. And then they were looking for a replacement. So, at least in the interim. So they interviewed me, Sergeant Darbert, Sergeant Ferullo, and Detective Carl Filsinger for that interim position. And I'd only been a sergeant for about 18 months, so I was just really doing the interview for the experience. But, you know, when you go into an interview with that attitude, it's almost like I really enjoyed my job as a sergeant. So I really had everything to gain and nothing to lose, at least by going in and interviewing. I felt very comfortable going in. And I explained to the commission the things that I thought were important that needed to be addressed, at least in the interim, when it came to some of the training issues that we were behind in and those types of things and some other things that we had to deal with. And so they gave me the interim position, and then, which I was grateful for. And then I figured, this is going to be a really great thing. I can put on my resume. I'm a patrol sergeant. Now I'm the interim chief, and when the new guy comes in, I can hopefully hand over the torch to him with a clean desk and help him, kind of amalgamate into the police department. And as time went forward, it came time where there was a deadline for putting in your application for the permanent position, and a couple of the police commissioners caught my ear and said, "Are you going to be doing that?" And I said, "Well, I'm not sure." And they said, "Well, you should, because you're doing a good job." So I did. And there were 97 applicants for that position at that time, for the full-time position, which included Detective Filsinger and Mike Ferullo, who I knew were my biggest competition because I knew what terrific cops they were. And lo and behold, after all the interviews and whittling down the pile of applications and everything, they gave the permanent position to me, which to this day I still owe a huge debt of gratitude to the town of Weston for that opportunity as well.
What year was that?
It was May of 2007 when they gave me the interim position, and it was January of 2008 when they gave me the permanent position. I wasn't sworn in until, I think, July of that year, 2008, because as the permanent chief, because I was going through contract negotiations with the town.
What was your relationship to the police commission over time? One naturally thinks of town politics, of personalities, mm-hmm. of perhaps a natural conflict between the aspirations of a police chief and the aspirations of a town. But let's focus specifically on your relationship to the police commission and how that worked and how well it worked or how well it didn't work from your perspective.
I think my relationship with the police commission worked very well. I think what I did in the beginning is I established a relationship with them where I would bring them in on making decisions for the department, which I think was lacking with the two previous administrations. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to bring them in on making decisions for whatever it was, either putting a stop sign in someplace or greater things like purchasing equipment or bringing them in on the hiring process, where I would have them come in and they would help with the physical agility when we're hiring people. They would be there and help time people on the runs. They would be monitoring the other parts of the test. I would have them, the ones that were available, come in and proctor a written test with me, which we would be presenting. So I would got them more involved with the hands-on of operations, the general operations of the police department. I think that worked very well, not only for me and for the commission, but also for the department and for the town. Because my philosophy was always to pretty much be an open book as to the things that I wanted to accomplish and the things that I thought were important. And the only way to really accomplish that was to be able to get a team on your side. And my team directly at that point was the police commission. And I was very successful with at least convincing four out of the seven of certain things. I did find, too, that of the makeup of the police commission, as long as I was involved as the chief of police, was always four of them were Republicans and three of them were Democrats. But they never, from what I can recall, ever made a decision based right down on party lines. It was always a mix. So I think the communication was good, and I think we worked well together.
Did you mention a couple of people who you seemed to say were a little less sympathetic or more critical, or how would you characterize it, and what was that about?
I will tell you that it was a learning experience going from being in a union position, even as a sergeant, to going into a non-union position as a chief of police, because you've heard the old saying, no man is an island. Well, I will tell you, chiefs of police are islands, okay? You do not have any real supporters from the police department anymore. You're not in the union, and you're their boss. Okay, so, and as far as the police commission goes, or anyone in the town government for the most part, they're politicians. So you're in a position where you're in between the union, which you have a union contract with the police officers that you have to abide by. So there's only certain things you can do and certain changes you can make without negotiating that. If you do these certain things and somebody in the union files a grievance, then the grievance goes in front of the police commission. The police commission has to try to sort it out, step two level. As a police chief, looking on the political side, you're in a political position, but you are not allowed to have a political opinion of any sort. So basically, you may agree or disagree with people in these political positions, but it cannot be based on your political philosophy, whatever that might be. I was fortunate growing up, my parents, as much as they're Republicans growing up, they always had a middle-of-the-road political kind of position with things. I will say that they never voted for a Democrat for president, but I know that my dad was the town moderator in Walpole, Massachusetts as a Republican, and Massachusetts being, and exactly Walpole, Massachusetts, was a highly Democratic controlled state and town. He was a Republican, he became the town moderator, which they didn't have a, for a selectman, they had a board, a town council, and then they had the moderator who would be the one that would run the meetings. But the town moderator was kind of looked to as kind of the go-to person. Now, when he became town moderator, and when he became on, he was on the board too, he was able to make political appointments. Now, when he made political appointments, he didn't put people in positions based on whether they're Republican or Democrat. He was very proud of the fact, and you're probably gonna end up talking to him about this someday, of the fact that when he made a political appointment, he would pick the right person for that position, not based on what party they were in either. And he said it even ruffled feathers in a lot of Republicans that he would appoint Democrats to certain positions in town government, knowing because that they were the best one for the position. But it's like his party was not happy with that, because then we're like, well, you know, it's our turn now, but this is the right guy. Mm-hmm. So I came from a family that, number one, if I ever had any question about how to handle small town politics in my position, I had two people I could go to immediately. It was my mom and dad. So I had that luxury that I had that type of a team behind me. But as a chief of police, you really have no allies from the police department or from the town government. So you're kind of an island in between. So the minute you don't please somebody or somebody doesn't agree with something that you do, from either side, you're gonna get either a grievance from the police union, or you're gonna get some kind of complaint from somebody in the town government, be that from the selectmen, be that from the Board of Finance, be that from the Board of Police Commissioners. Or even I've experienced it from the school board. people weren't happy with some of the things that I either said or did. But as a police chief, and I know that there's been a new one that's going to be sworn in on Monday, my suggestion to him would be, understand the fact that you're pretty much on your own as chief of police. You don't have any allies from either side. And that being said, what you need to do is focus on the things that you think are important to the town and the department, especially to the town, to keep the town safe, because that's your job, is to keep the town safe. And push those things as hard as you can, especially in your honeymoon period when you first come on, because you got a good year to 18 months where people are going to love you, especially on the political side. Push your agenda as hard as you can and get those things accomplished and in place. Because as time goes by, you're going to ruffle feathers, because we think and we see things through police colored glasses. I always told people, if they came into my office, what is your biggest burden? My biggest burden was the school system. Because especially after Sandy Hook, I would tell people, you open my window, you can hear the kids playing in the playground. So to me, as a chief of police, my ground zero is the school complex. So again, going back to thinking nationally and acting locally, what's happening nationally? You've got school shootings, you've got all sorts of things happening at schools because they're what's known as a soft target. So how do I best go about protecting the schools and protecting the officers who may have to respond to one of these tragedies? So you have to outfit them with certain kinds of equipment that maybe isn't politically correct. Rifles, heavy duty types of bulletproof vests, different kinds of equipment to breach doors. All of these things that you have to, as a chief of police, convince, number one, the police commission that you need them and why you need them. And number two, then you have to go through the whole rigmarole during the budget process of getting going in front of the selectmen and not having them cut that out of the budget. And if they don't cut it out of the budget, then you have to go in front of the Board of Finance and explain why it is that you need assault rifles, or why it is that you need breaching tools to break into doors. Why do you need battering rams? Why do you need Humvees, even if you're getting them for free? Why is that? Why do we need that in Weston? But for somebody who does not think like a police officer or does not look at things through police colored glasses, that is something that you can't really understand. I think my biggest beef with the town government is, if you put somebody in place and they're your local expert for what is needed for police protection or for the protection of the town as a whole, and he comes to you with a suggestion that you need a certain piece of equipment or a certain kind of training, then you should take his word for it. Now, if there's an issue about how to pay for it, that's something else. But the chief of police shouldn't have to explain why tasers are important to the first selectman, and then I literally got tasered on video to prove that didn't cause serious physical injury, and I presented that in front of the selectmen. And because certain selectmen didn't like the idea of tasers in Weston, they decided they weren't going to pay for them. But they said that you can go out and get donations. And immediately, within a week, I had enough donations to buy all the tasers I needed, which I will say that as a chief of police, you don't have any allies from the police department. You don't have any allies from the town government. Your allies are in the community. These people in the community that you're sworn to protect and serve, those are where you're going to find your allies. And that's where I found many of my allies, were in the town and the residents of the town that understood why I was trying to accomplish certain things. I always got the most support from the people in town.
But one might... I remember the question about the tasers very well. You surely wouldn't want to have the town, the political forces in town, be a rubber stamp, because the experts say we need X, and therefore the town should understand, and therefore the town should pay for X. Moreover, in terms of the overall psychological climate social climate. Perhaps there are people in town who feel, well, the police are weaponized enough as it is. Yes, we realize that Weston, like other towns, have problems, potential violence, but this is a, we pride ourselves on being a relatively rural community, easy community. Why should we have a police department that has Humvees, tasers, doorbusters, etc.? So just from that, mm-hmm. you know, critique, how would you respond to that?
See, that's where the problem lies. I think the problem lies, and I think it's the responsibility of the chief of police to be able to vocalize and make the public understand why these things are needed. And of course, you cannot share your feelings of and experiences with the general public, like I was saying, like you can with your officers. You know, I've seen a lot of things in this small town that most people would think, you know, could never happen here. And I've also, our officers have assisted people in other departments in other towns. Most recently, the Sandy Hook incident, where you would never think that could happen in a small town. Especially, it's always happening somewhere else, far, far away. It's never happening within the Fairfield County area, let alone it can't happen in Weston. But I think that the job of the police chief is to basically educate the public as to what is needed and why. And again, I think that you can roll it back to, you can wait till it chimes three times, but you can roll it back to basically, you know, hey, you know, this is why, this is my experience. I'm gonna educate you the best that I can in my ability of why police officers have to be equipped with certain things. You can look at nationally what happens at these school shootings. You know, nationally, what happens if police officers aren't properly trained, what their reactions are to certain situations. Nationally, what happens if police officers don't have the right tools to deal with certain people, so they go to the tool that they have, which may be their sidearm versus a taser versus pepper spray. I even remember when Chief Land was trying to get the town to the police commission to agree to, you know, equipping the guys with pepper spray. That was a whole nother thing. That was way before tasers. That was before rifles. Nobody can understand why Weston needs pepper spray. But it's, if you have less lethal options, not to say that they wouldn't be lethal. Sometimes things happen, even with pepper spray. You spray somebody with pepper, somebody falls down and bangs their head, and then they die of a concussion. That's happened before. Same thing with tasers. They don't call them non-lethal, they call them less lethal options that the officers can work with. Now, what I found is, too, that there's a certain thing called verbal judo, that, you know, officers go to that kind of training, learning how to talk to people. I've told people, it's interesting that sometimes I would go to some of these like elementary school classes and I'd do a presentation, you know, what I carry on my belt and this and that. And they would say, one child asked me, what's your favorite weapon that you carry? And I said, my favorite weapon that I carry is my brain. Because as a human being, as an officer, you know, you have to develop your brain to be able to outthink the person that you're dealing with. And if you can do that, you can de-escalate any situation just by using your brain. You don't need all these weapons. But there are those times when things escalate that you have no control, that you need to have these other options available. But you don't want to go from talking, and the only other option I have is shooting. You want to have talking, okay, that's not working. What do I have? Oh, I have my pepper spray. Okay, well, that didn't work. Well, let's do the taser then. Okay, that didn't work. He's still coming at me. Okay, then maybe I have to use my sidearm. You know, so this is the thing. This is how we try to educate the public how this works. And that's how police officers are trained, too. There's I forget what it's exactly called, but there's a graph that the officers look at. And it's basically how things escalate and how to respond to the escalation appropriately. And they're trained in that. But if you are missing some of the tools in between where, okay, it's verbal judo, and then, well, if we had pepper spray, we would use it here, but we don't have that. So maybe I have to go to a billy club. I have to use my flashlight to try to hit this guy, you know, which could cause serious physical injury. Or if I don't have a taser and all I have is a sidearm and it escalates to the point where I am in fear for my physical, my own physical well-being, or possibly this person could kill me if I don't stop him. If I don't have that extra tool of the taser before I move to my sidearm, then that's got a tragedy written all over it. Not just a tragedy for the person that gets shot, but for the officer too, because the officer is a human being too. And he has to deal with the aftermath of that.
Yeah. Is it that kind of give and take or not give and take with the town that caused you to resign the first time?
I think it was funny because, it is funny. Because they sent me to all different kinds of seminars for chiefs of police and chiefs of police training. And one of the things that I would hear over and over in these seminars is, as a chief of police, you have to know the signs when it's time for you to basically throw in the towel or hand a torch off to somebody else. When you start running into brick walls, when you're trying to accomplish something, when your own boards or police commissions or the public isn't supporting you at all to the point where you cannot move forward with accomplishing the things that you need to do, it usually means that your time is up. So one of the things that happened, and there were a number of things that were working up to it, but one of the things that was kind of the deciding point for me was, and it wasn't because of any one person in the town government, it wasn't anything like that. It was a sign that I got that I brought back these free Humvees from Ford Drum, these two Humvees that we got. All we had to do was sign a piece of paper, and they were issued to us under the LISO program, the law enforcement officers program through the military surplus, and we could bring them back. So we drove them back, and we had to spend about $300 on diesel fuel to get them back from Fort Drum. And this was after I got the approval through emails from the police commission to go and pick these things up. And when I brought them back, one of the first selectmen at the time thought that she was supposed to be in the deciding factor of any of this kind of acquisition, and turned into all these meetings and this and that. And then the police commission at that point started kind of like their support, kind of because of they're being their politicians, like I said. As long as you're pleasing everybody on that side, they're your friend. But as soon as you ruffle feathers, your support starts to dissolve. I could see the support dissolving. I had to go to a couple different meetings to explain how the acquisition happened and how I exposed the emails from the commission supporting it. But literally, I said at that point, you know, I'm hitting a brick wall bringing these free vehicles back to the town at no cost to the town with the exception of $300 worth of diesel fuel, and I can't move forward. Therefore, I see this as the sign that I've learned about at all these seminars that, you know what, it's time to kind of hand the torch up. Let somebody else pick up the torch, use their honeymoon period with the town to maybe accomplish some things. But quite frankly, another thing I learned at some of these chief seminars was that the average span of life for any chief of police is 5 years, as far as the career goes. Not life cycle, but 5 years. I lasted just under 10 years. I think that's a pretty good run. When I was going to leave, that was right around 5 years when I put in my resignation. Now, one of the things I will say that my deciding factor to actually stay after that was the public came to my aid. And they, Bob Gardner and Fran Goldstein specifically, went out and they got people to sign a petition to keep me. And I don't even know, I've never counted the amount of signatures, but that didn't matter to me anyway. The fact that I stayed was because of those two people. That when I found out the one Monday morning when they came to see me that they had gotten all these signatures out in front of Weston Center, during February on a Sunday afternoon. They're out there for 5 hours, and it was cold out. These two people, that's why I stayed, because if two people would stay out there in the cold, even if they didn't get any signatures, you know, that's my support system right there. That's my public saying, you know, it's not time for you to leave yet. So I stayed because of that. And I was able to actually accomplish some more things after that, which I'm very proud of. But again, I think my career lasted as a chief of police lasted longer than most do in this day and age. We had a police chief in Wilton recently that he was the assistant chief for 3 years, and then he got the chief's position. He was there for 2 years, and he threw in his towel. We had Chief Call over in Westport that was, I think, just 5 years he was chief, and he decided to retire from the position. Basically, you can see the lifespan of the career of any chief of police is, like I said, 3 to 5 years.